Yes, I didn't hear. I was speaking up this morning. I was speaking up practitioner Kara Jamba this morning. He's an extremely talented person. He did properly introduce her. That would be another presentation. She has many gifts, and today she's going to share her gift of encouragement with us this morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the Temple of Light, Center for Spiritual Living. And to all those who are listening to us on the World Wide Web, welcome. It's a beautiful sunny day in Jamaica. We have wonderful, radiant golden villas just blazing with color. So welcome. Would you please stand and join me in the first hymn? On page 5.
Now, anyone who's traveled to Europe and the Far East
has experienced the phenomenon of leaving on Sunday morning at 6 o'clock and arriving on Saturday morning at 2 a.m., the day before he left. So what happened to time? Einstein's general theory of relativity allows for the possibility that we could warp space-time so much that you could go off in a rocket and return before you left. So when we speak about light years, it's incomprehensible to the average man that time can travel at the speed of light. And so yes, 1,000 years would conceivably be a day, an hour. Obviously, that kind of time is measured differently to chronological time, and apparently it's not very logical, at least not to me. The concept of time, according to Stephen Hawking, has no meaning before the beginning of the universe. So where did the universe come from? Since we can't pinpoint when that is, the concept of time has little meaning except as a measurement of a sequence of events. But if the only time is now, this present moment, where is yesterday? Where is tomorrow? For instance, if you take a photograph, it becomes a frozen moment in time. But every time you look at that photograph, you're experiencing that moment now. So time really is imaginary. There is no time as a fixed thing. There are moments of experience simultaneously occurring in some time-space sequence. I bet you're figuring where I'm going with this, right? Now, any reference to time in the Bible, and particularly in the New Testament, is speaking to a process of unfoldment, not a fixed event. If we want to look at the timelessness of time, we need to look no further than the passion story of Jesus the Christ, as told in the New Testament. Now, this event that occurs, that I'm going to read to you, is the event that surrounds what we call Palm Sunday or Passion Sunday. And in the Christian tradition, it is often described as Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. Let me read it for you. I like the version that's in Mark chapter 11, verse 1 to 11. And when they came nigh to Jerusalem, unto Bethphage and Bethany, at the Mount of Olives, he sent forth two of his disciples, and said unto them, Go your way into the village over against you, and as soon as ye be entered into it, ye shall find a colt tied, whereon never man sat. Loose him, and bring him. And if any man say unto you, Why do ye this? Say ye that the Lord hath need of him, and straightway he will send him hither. And they went their way, and found the colt tied by the door, without in a place where two ways met. And they loosed him. And certain of them that stood there said unto them, What do ye loosing the colt? And they said unto them, Even as Jesus had commanded, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus, and cast their garments on him, and he sat upon him. And many spread their garments in the way, and others cut down branches of the trees, and strawed them in the way. And they that went before, and they that followed, cried, saying, Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the kingdom of our father David that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And Jesus entered into Jerusalem and into the temple. And when he had looked round about upon all things, and how the eventide was come, he went out unto Bethany with the 12. Now, as a bit of history, it's an interesting story enough, but as a metaphysical teaching, it's quite significant. Now, you will notice in the Bible, there's a huge gap in the story of Jesus between the birth and the accounts of his ministry at age 33. And the events in the New Testament following, particularly all the books of the New Testament, leading up to his entry into Jerusalem,
it's like these teachings and miracles are going along at a gallop. They escalate, they accelerate, almost as if he felt an urgency to get the message out. Now it's important that we understand the symbols in the story. All the significant events in the Bible are teaching us about ourselves, our journey, our place in the universe, and how to navigate the stressors. This triumphal entry into Jerusalem via Bethphage is not accidental. This journey signifies a progressive unfoldment in consciousness, the fulfillment of the time that the spiritual I am takes control. It is a season for transformation. According to the Metaphysical Bible Dictionary, Bethphage means a place of unripe fruit, whereas Jerusalem means the abiding consciousness of spiritual peace. In other words, fulfillment, the redeemed state of mankind returned to Godkind. So you can see the progress that Jesus is making with each teaching, with each miracle that is performed. There is something happening to him as well. The way to Jerusalem, then, is the way of the Christ. And the Christ is our identification with that I am consciousness, the perfect expression of all the mental faculties we recognize as God. Be with me. Peace, harmony, prosperity, wholeness, love, faith, joy. These are mental faculties recognized as God. And these faculties are represented by Jesus' disciples. Next time you read about Jesus and the disciples, think about it in a new way. It's not just a story. Now, several times leading up to this entry into Jerusalem, after each marathon of teaching and healing, Jesus went up into the mountains with just a couple of his disciples to pray and to center himself. Going up into the mountains is about elevating your consciousness. So he was definitely and deliberately preparing himself in consciousness to fulfill the prophecy. And he was tapping into the mental faculties he needed for that journey. We're told in Mark 1, verse 15, Jesus said, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel." So, repent means to rethink. So we rethink our position with faith and belief as our anchor. Then, when the time comes, we recognize and accept the presence of God in the present moment, and fear subsides. The next step is surrender. Not to my will, but thine. These are the words of Jesus. That was the last prayer that Jesus prayed before his arrest. And following his prayer, he released his disciples to their rest. Remember, they were in the mountain in the garden and they were never asleep. He left them alone. He said, "It is enough. The hour is come. Now is the time." Jesus was ready to prove the timelessness of time, the infiniteness of divinity, the possibility of life everlasting. His charge to his disciples after his resurrection, as recorded in Luke 13:35, says, "Ye shall not see me until the time come when ye shall say, Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord." In other words, until you recognize the inherent nature of God, you will not be able to see the Christ nature, to recognize that I am consciousness, either in yourself or in others. That which can claim, "All power is given me in heaven and in earth." He leaves them with an assurance in Matthew 28, verse 20, "Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." Stephen Hawking says, "Nothing cannot exist forever," which means everything exists forever. We've often said that Jesus is a great example. rather than the great exception. And we are called through his teachings to follow, not to keep him outside our frame of reference, as the strange but wonderful guy or younger who knew miraculous things. No, his mission was to prove the eternality of life, that there is no beginning and no end, except when we deny that life lives. As long as we're still breathing, we are waiting for God, aka life, to show up in the universe. And even after the physical form has returned to the dust, the spirit of life still lives. Our Declaration of Principles, or the Religious Science of Mind, states, we believe in the eternality, the immortality, and the continuity of the individual soul forever and ever expanding. Can you wrap your mind around the vastness of infinity as an ever-expanding universe, a limitless experience? Let me tell you how Stephen Hawking says it. We have developed, now there's some scientific terms in here, okay? We have developed from the geocentric cosmologies of Ptolemy and his forebears to the heliocentric cosmology of Copernicus and Galileo to the modern picture in which the Earth is a medium-sized planet orbiting around an average star in the outer suburbs of an ordinary spiral galaxy, which is itself only one of about a million galaxies in the observable universe. How's that for putting things in perspective, okay? Earth is a speck of dust. Think about that for a minute. But what a speck of dust we are. He also, Stephen had mentioned he passed away last week. His physical body could no longer support his lividity. But what an incredible consciousness he had. He is quoted as saying, to confine our attention to terrestrial matters would be to limit the human spirit, end quote. Do you know that he could barely move one joint of one index finger? I mean, my picture is. Okay? That was the extent of his physical ability. Yet he went on to be one of, if not the most celebrated physicist in the entire world. He taught university classes, he traveled extensively, he was married and had two children. He had a great sense of humor, and a joke that he's probably more famous for his wheelchair and gadgets than for anything he said. Well, we don't know about that. The truth is, vision has no limits. It's not trespassing or flying in the face of God to go beyond our own self-imposed boundaries. Your circumstances nor your history do not define you. Here's an affirmation for you. I'll read it once and then you can say it together. Divine wisdom guides me into paths of service which successfully utilize my innate talents and abilities. I'll break it down. Divine wisdom guides me.
Divine wisdom guides me
into paths of service.
Into paths of service
which successfully utilize my innate talents and abilities.
Which successfully utilize my innate talents and abilities.
Now you know you can't be guided if you're not willing to surrender and be led. Now the fact that, you know, that colt that Jesus asked them to bring, the colt was a young donkey. So it had not ever been ridden by a man. It was brand new in mind. We have to make ourselves available to the greater yet to be. We have to become that vehicle through which spirit can express. Jesus successfully surrendered, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And over 2,000 years later, we're still doubting the truth of his experience as a possibility for us. The truth is, Infinity is not something we go to or acquire. We're living our infinity right now. How could it be otherwise? Infinity is, well, infinite. There is no beginning, no end. It's unqualified, unrestrained, borderless, and boundless. Infinity is infinite. Consciousness, which equals awareness, is the awareness of something which is infinite. And Jesus cultivated that consciousness through his frequent pauses to reconnect with the indwelling God. You can't get there if you won't go there. And one of the most effective ways is through a consistent meditation practice. Each of us carries within us the blueprint of divinity. How do we identify it? How do we recognize it when we see it or feel it? Ralph Waldo Emerson suggests, and I quote, "Place yourself in the middle of the stream of power and wisdom which flows into you as life. Place yourself in the full center of that flood. Then you are, without effort, impelled to truth, to right, and a perfect contentment. Then you are a world, the measure of right, of truth, of beauty." End quote. Life will be expressed. Life lives. Life can only live. How it will be expressed is entirely up to us, though. We must be willing to express an ever greater understanding of truth. We must be willing to ride into our Jerusalem with an unwavering awareness that we are not now and can never be separate from God, because it is in us, as us. Affirm with me, I'll read it once. I remain in constant conscious contact with the indwelling presence. I remain in constant conscious contact with the indwelling presence. Let us recognize that we are in partnership with an omnipotent power, an infinite intelligence, and an unconditional love. It's about time. Declare with me, I am God in expression.
I am God in expression.